years that I was in that system, give or take, that's 2,800 chapel presentations. Not once did anybody look at me, point a finger, and say, repent and trust the Savior. And there is a debate raging in evangelicalism and in seminaries today about the word repentance and what it even means. And so this morning, I would like to suggest to you, we got to figure out what the Bible meant when it said repent and trust the Savior, because otherwise, we're going to be creating more false converts. There are two words, Kirk earlier alluded to these, two words that the Bible uses for repentance, metanoia and metamelomai. Metanoia is a godly sorrow that 2 Corinthians talks about that leads to repentance, a brokenness over our sin, because against you and you only have I sinned. Metamelomai is, she's going to leave me if she finds out about this. I could get fired. That's metamelomai. And you know who practiced metamelomai in the Bible? A couple of famous characters. Esau, who sold his birthright for a pot of stew, and Judas Iscariot felt very badly about what he did to Jesus because of the consequences, but he never had godly sorrow leading to repentance. And these days in seminaries, I'm sorry, with all due respect, at least these days, half of the professors at Dallas Theological Seminary believe that repentance is merely a change of mind. I used to think this about Jesus, now I think this. When the historic biblical understanding of repentance is not just a change of mind, it is a change of mind, a change of heart, a change of will, a change of attitude, a change of direction, a change of passions. I was going this way, loving me and loving my sin. I met the Savior, and now I'm going this way. That is biblical repentance, and I'd like to share with you this morning not only the Bible verses that support that, but the finest in Greek scholarship. What do they say about this word that's used 30 times in the New Testament in conjunction with salvation? Let's take a look together. Colin Brown, Greek scholar. The predominantly intellectual understanding of metanoia as a change of mind plays very little part in the New Testament, rather the decision by the whole man to turn around is stressed. It is clear we are concerned neither with a purely outward turning nor with a merely intellectual change of ideas. Imagine this, ladies, you'll love this. I committed adultery. Imagine the scenario. And I go back to my wife, and I want to be reconciled to my wife. I have violated our covenant vow. And I walk in and I say, honey, I just want you to know I've committed adultery, but I've changed my mind about you. Can you imagine? And yet, millions are told that's all they must do with the Savior. We have sinned against him by committing adultery, by being fornicators and blasphemers and liars, and we're simply told we need to have a new attitude about Jesus? Are you kidding me? Consider what Gerhard Kittel had to say about metanoia, if you will. The term demands radical conversion, demands a transformation of nature, a definitive turning from evil, a resolute turning to God in total obedience. Once and for all, no going back. This is sanctification. Now only advance and responsible movement along the way now taken, it affects the whole man. Not talking about perfection here, but we are talking about direction. Do Christians fall? Yes, we fall. But we don't dive, and we don't swim, and we don't live there, because it's perfectly clear. 1 John 3:8-9, if you keep on sinning, your lifestyle is marked by sinning, this is pretty clear, you're of the devil. Christians sin, but they do it hating it, not wanting to do it, fighting against it. The Bible makes it clear, 2 Corinthians 7, for the sorrow that is according to the will of God produces a repentance without regret, leading to salvation. But the sorrow of the world, metamelomai, produces death. I would like to suggest to you, and just so we're clear on this, repentance, Martin Luther made it clear when he banged the 95 theses against the church door, the first one, that a Christian's life is marked, it's a lifestyle of repentance. I'm not talking about a daily confession of sins. I'm talking about this one-time conversion experience that is marked when we are saved by God, when we die to selves, call out to him for mercy, putting our trust in Jesus Christ. That's the repentance that I speak of right now. I think there's six parts of repentance that must happen. And frankly, it only makes sense and it's supported biblically. Here we are in lovely sunny California, and I say, hey gang, it's a little chilly this morning, so let's drive to Mexico. I've been there before. Come on. I've got a bus in the back. Let's go. And we all jump into the bus, and we start driving, and hours go by, and we drive by a bank, and you notice that the temperature is actually getting colder. You're seeing a lot of pine trees, and all of a sudden there's a sign that says Canada, 142 miles. Now I'm going in the wrong direction. I'm guessing you want me to repent. Six things you'd like me to do. First of all, after you pointed out the signs to me, you want me to agree. You know what, friend? You are right. We are headed in the wrong direction. But that's not all you want. You don't want me to simply agree with you. You want me to stop. And so does God. Stop sinning. Apologize. Turn around. Start heading in the opposite direction, and don't stop until you get there. That's repentance. And we must have that at salvation granted by God, or we will not be saved. Listen to what Charles Spurgeon said, and this is serious business, what the Prince of Preachers said. True repentance is a turning of the heart as well as of the life. It is the giving up of the whole soul to God to be His forever and ever. It is a renunciation of the sins of the heart. Don't become perfect. As well as the corruptions of life. All sin must be given up, or else you will never have Christ. All evil must be renounced, or else the gates of heaven must be locked to keep you up forever. Do you think Jesus Christ became a human being, the greatest miracle of all time, the incarnation, the infinite, omnipresent, omnipowerful God, stuffed into a human body to take the punishment that we deserve for our sins, the great exchange, our badness put on Him, His goodness credited to our account, imputed to us so that we are seen as perfect, so that we can enter heaven with something we love more than Him? It's preposterous. All sin must be given up, hated. And I know for a fact